The next speaker, Ms. Ramin Ganeshram. Before I invite her, I know you're all getting very hungry to eat, and she's going to whet your appetite very well. But I'd like to declare about 5 minutes for those of you who have to go to the restrooms and come back. They're not too far. They're right here. So take... For those of you who came in a little bit too late to this conference, I'd like to remind you we are the Asian American Asian Research Institute. My name is Nehru Cherukupalli, and I'm the Interim Executive Director. And the conference that you're attending is the Caribbean Asians, The Journey Continues. And this is being sponsored by our institute and by GOPIO, that's the Global Organization of People of Indian Origin, and GICA, Guyanese East Indian Civic Association, and of course the New York City Mayor's Office of Immigration Affairs, who is celebrating this whole week, the Immigrant Week of New York City. And I'd like to welcome you all again. And after the short break, I hope you didn't eat too much of the food, because there's going to be a big lunch coming up not too far from now, within about maybe half hour or 45 minutes. The lunch will be here. And talking about lunch, the correct person to talk about lunch is really our next speaker. And I really cannot describe all the attributes that Ramin Ganeshram has. She's a journalist, she's a cookbook editor, author, everything. As a matter of fact, if you looked at this morning's New York Times, you can see her picture in the New York Times, and it is, the cutting of it is posted on the door outside. And of course, I'm really happy to see not just the picture, the person in real life. There is Ramin, and I'm so glad. Please. And she's going to be talking to us about Indians in Trinidad. I'm sorry. She's going to be talking about food. All right? Just hold off. You're going to be treated for a Caribbean lunch. But as a prelude, I present Ramin. Let's see. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Cherukupalli. Thank you, everybody, for coming today. I appreciate it so much to see you all here. I'd also like to thank somebody who's very important to this conference, Daryl Sifdeo, who really organized this and did a wonderful job. He's even now running around, I think, organizing that lunch. So, but I do want to thank him very much. So I'd like to... Well, first of all, what I'm going to talk about is the fact that food, which is such a simple thing, right? It's just what we have every day. It's what we eat at home. We don't think about it. But food is a really good indicator of our migration patterns as Asian people coming to the Caribbean. You can read a recipe and understand there were Chinese people who came to Trinidad, to Guyana, to Cuba. There were Indian people who came. There were African people who came. Our recipes have become a mix, an amalgam of our culture. So I want to start out by reading you an email that I received from a would-be student. I teach at the Institute of Culinary Education. I'm a professionally trained chef. And I received an email from a student, a very well-meaning and eager student who wanted to learn about authentic Indian food. And she writes, "Dear Chef, I'm interested in taking some authentic Indian cooking classes, particularly with a true home feel. Will you be teaching a class like that anytime soon?" As my fingers were poised over the keys to respond, something gave me pause. The brief little note said a lot more than it would seem. Clearly, the writer figured from my name, I had a specific personal knowledge about cooking authentic Indian food. But the truth is that the first time I had chicken korma was in an Indian restaurant. My famous chicken tikka masala was a recipe obtained from a Punjabi chef I interviewed for a Newsday story. It was an Indian languages professor who taught me to make puris. I learned to make shrimp biryani from one of Mother Joffrey's very excellent cookbooks. And the fact is that the email writer's culturally aware assumption was all wrong. Despite my very Indian surname of Ganeshram, or more properly Ganeshram, despite the fact that my father spoke Hindi, despite the fact that my great-grandfather wore a dhoti until his dying days, I am not an Indian. I'm a Trinidadian. I am, like many of you, a descendant of one of the thousands of laborers of East Indian and Chinese descent who was brought to the Caribbean for the express purpose of cutting sugarcane and harvesting cocoa. And the story of our history and adaptation to the new world can be eloquently told both in our disconnect from the foods of the mother countries of China and India and the cuisine we developed in the West Indies. So this began on the actual ships that brought our ancestors to the Caribbean. Even though most indentures, they brought their tawas, they brought their bilnas, they brought their woks, they brought their packets of spice, their food stores had to be supplemented by what was offered on board ship. So what did this mean? This meant that the English and the European colonists, indentured, what would you call the merchants in the flesh trade, provided what they ate, provided what they thought was very excellent food. And toward this end, I'd like to read you a passage from the ship's diary of W.H. Angel, the captain of a ship called Sheila, a clipper ship that went from India to Trinidad in 1877. And he says, "The coolies have their own cooks in strict accordance with their caste or faith, though caste is in great measure broken by the mere fact of their leaving India and coming to sea. They consumed a great quantity of rice and curry, which they mined from the fresh ingredients we supplied. A much appreciated meal was a curry of boiled rice and fresh mutton, or in lieu thereof, tinned mutton or preserved fish. On 3 days a week, they each had three or sometimes four chapatis for dinner in lieu of rice. A chapati is a pancake made of flour and ghee, a native butter, baked on immense steam-heated iron plates, fancy making upwards of 2,000 of those. Then they were given, it goes on to say, they were given a ketterji of fish, a lot of various vegetables, pumpkins, etc. But this is the most telling point. He says, if they were at all seedy or off color, special treatment of food, plenty of port wine, extract of beef, chicken broth, condensed milk, and a host of good things, so they ought to have been fit." So now, those of you who are familiar with the culture of Hindu Indians and Muslim Indians, extract of beef is really not on the regular menu. Yeah. Neither is port wine, whether you're Muslim or Hindu. In many cases, many of the Brahmin casted indentures would not have eaten chicken broth either, or chicken. So these unaccustomed and religiously prescripted products almost always cause severe illness, a fact that had become so well understood that the rectification had to be borne out in time. And they understood this. They understood that by 4 to 5 weeks into the journey, they became very ill, that their human passage, their human cargo became very ill. And what did that mean? That meant that they weren't going to get, really, their reputations would be ruined. You know, you bring sick indentures to come work on sugar estates and cocoa estates, which meant they had to be in hospital, which meant that had to be at the cost of either the shipping company or the plantation owner. That's not good business. So he writes, "For the first 6 or 7 weeks out, there are always a number of cases which give the doctors a good deal of anxiety. The trouble is caused chiefly by the unaccustomed food and too much of it. Their stomachs and their forebear stomachs for many generations have not been used to such stimulating food. This continues for 45 to 50 days on average. But for the rest of the passage, they pick up wonderfully, finally arriving in port in the pink of condition, fit to go at once at the to the plantation. And he goes on to say that this is the benefit of a clipper ship, a sail ship, versus a steamship, which will get there about 2 weeks early. And you really need those 2 weeks for them to buck up under this really fortifying food and alcohol and become fit to work on the plantation. So what does this mean? It means that you would think once you get to land, once you get to the estate, you're going to go back to your food ways. Oh, thank God I don't have to have beef broth anymore. That's not what happened. You can imagine that in the throes of illness and hunger and culture shock, it's a devastating event to suddenly be forced to consume something that your religious, your cultural heritage tells you is not only taboo, but could affect your reincarnation into the next life. It could affect the generations of your family to come. So once such a huge taboo is overcome, what happens? What happens is that other things can be overcome. It's kind of like anything's fair game at that point. And this is actually what happened. So the result was that the new food that was created in the Caribbean also carries information about the circumstances that Asian Caribbeans endured when they first arrived. For example, indigenous local vegetables like what is commonly called ground provisions, those of you who are West Indian will know that that is taro, yuca, manioc, and batata, along with ration foods like breadfruit. Breadfruit was brought actually to the Caribbean from the South Pacific by Captain Cook. It was brought specifically to feed slaves because it's very filling, and later indentureds. So they found their way into the Indian cooking pot as curries or masalas created without the extra touches of a particular spice or ingredient that made the mixture uniquely and regionally specific. And this is why you generally have, for the most part, throughout the Caribbean, curry is generally a relatively uniform thing. It does have a mixture of spices. An individual might change the ratio based on their particular taste, but it doesn't have the vast deviations that you'll have in different parts of India. And that's pretty much because the spices were not available, especially on such a highly specific regional level. So while shops did crop up on the estate selling Indian goods, they did not provide every single item in an Asian cook's recipe box. And so little by little, the staple items of one's ancestral cuisines fell away. So what did these include? Clove, asafoetida, tamarind, bay leaf, turmeric, ginger, chili powder, and yogurt. You know, they are used now because they're available, but sparingly in the West Indian cook's kitchen. And this is because they simply were not available at the time. Some other very pointed examples are traditional East Indian foods make a lot of use of dried and fresh whole peppers, chili peppers, in the cooking, within the stew or the curry or the other masala. And for the most part, in Indo-Caribbean food and Asian-Caribbean food, while there is a certain amount of pepper being used, if you'd make a comparison, a ratio of foods that are cooked in a relatively, you might say, a blander way, and then supplemented after with pepper sauce, with whole peppers. I remember my father used to eat curry with two or three huge peppers on a plate next to him, and he'd take a forkful of rice, for a bite of pepper, and many of you are probably very familiar with this, right? Things like yogurt and cream-based dishes couldn't be made because there are very few cows in the Caribbean. It's not conducive to raising cattle on a small island like Trinidad or Jamaica or Cuba. Another very interesting thing is the way the language that was used to describe foods morphed and changed, almost to the point where you had some very specific things happen. The first was that names were simply modified. There is a steamed pork bun that is made in Trinidad, I suspect it's made in Jamaica as well, called pow, What this actually is bao. If you go to Chinatown right now and you can go to Long Moon Bakery on Mulberry Street and buy a pork bun that is virtually exactly the same that you'll get from Shea Ten on Cipriani Boulevard in Port of Spain. And so it's interesting that the construct, the method of preparation, the flavoring in this one item did not change. It is very authentic. But the name has changed. And that's just a matter of people's languages fall away when you don't have one another to speak with. As Dr. Lai said initially, the groups of Chinese in Trinidad was a small number of people. So there was integration. People had to speak, first of all, English, since it was the language of the estate owners and of the British government. Other changes include, another example, there's a street food called Sahina, which is actually called Patra in India. I couldn't even tell you where that name Sahina came from. It's almost identical in preparation. It's taro leaves or dashin leaves with a paste, a bean flour paste, split pea in Trinidad and chickpea in India, sandwiched between it, rolled and then steamed. In Trinidad, they take it a step further and they deep fry it, because we love fried foods in the Caribbean, and it's a very popular street food. So not only do you have a name change, where you can't really narrow down where the name change came from, I'm sure a linguist could, but I'm not a linguist, you have that little extra step that makes it uniquely your own. A very, very telling example is something that is very dear to Jamaican and Trinidadian and Guyanese people's hearts, and that's roti, right? What would we be without our roti? I mean, I'm sure many of you have said, yes, you know, I'm from Guyana, I'm from Trinidad. People say, can you make roti? Can you teach me how to make that? So roti, however, what we call roti is not what is called roti in India, okay? The traditional Indian roti is more like, well, I'll read you what I had in my paper. It says, the version prepared in the Caribbean is unlike what East Indians call roti in that its cooking method upon an iron griddle called a tawa is more like that of a traditional chapati. While its ingredients are closer to that of naan in that it has a leavening agent. There's a lot of baking powder in roti, in Caribbean roti. So the examples go on and on about how these changes occur, both in name, both in preparation, both in the method of eating. But what's very interesting is that there's a certain group of foods that has not changed, and it's pretty authentic. And what those foods are religious foods, particularly Indian mithai or sweets that are used in Hindu religious ceremonies. They are virtually identical to what is served in India. There might be a few differences in name, but for the most part, the preparation is almost exact. And that in itself says a lot about these people's desire, even if they weren't successful across the board, their strong desire to maintain a cultural heritage. And the easiest way for them to do this in a society where they are bombarded by the difficulties of life, hard labor, the pressure to assimilate to a British system, that they could hold on to this one thing and relate to it consistently, even now, you know, 150 odd years after their arrival in the Caribbean is very telling. So what does all of this mean for students of Asian Caribbean culture groups? It means that just as linguistic cues can be traced back to their points of origin, telling a tale about which groups influenced the other and when, so can the common menu. A visit to any Caribbean restaurant is a primer in immigration. There is lo mein, there's curry, and pepper pot, which has strong African influences. These are just a few examples. So what about going forward? Now here we are twice removed from India, from China. So what does that mean for our food, right? We try to be authentic, but what is authentic? You know, the food of the Caribbean is in and of itself its own food, you know, and although you will have references in Trinidad, I know you will have references to people saying, well, I'm going to have Indian food, or this is an Indian thing, or interestingly, I would suspect, and I have no basis in fact, but just anecdotal observation that probably, you know, on a ratio basis, there are just as many Chinese restaurants in Trinidad per person in the population as there are here. You know, Chinese takeout, pardon, it's pretty standard in Trinidad, you know. But on the other hand, what we will all say is that's our food. That's, you know, roti, that's our food. You know, lo mein is our food. You know, my dad used to make fried rice. Never occurred to me that he shouldn't be, you know, why, you know, but that was Trinidadian food. But again, going forward, for the second generation, the third generation, even first generation, people like myself who had a parent from the Caribbean, but especially for those who did not have a parent directly from the Caribbean, who had a grandparent or what have you, there's a question. To what extent do you try to maintain your food culture, especially since what is your food culture? Now, do you go back to the food of India, the food of China, and try to re-authenticate yourself and your heritage? Those foods probably don't mean a lot to you on a personal basis. The flavors will be different. The presentation will be different. The reasons you eat certain things will be different. But yet, when we're in the agnostic environment of modern America, we have this opportunity, and a lot of this has to do with the fact, and I say this in the New York Times article that you may have read, is that physically many Asian Caribbeans still retain indigenous physical embodiments, right? I mean, if you walk up to an Indo-Caribbean, very likely, until they speak, you're not going to, here in the United States, you're not going to realize that they're from India or Trinidad or Guyana or Jamaica. Is true with people of Chinese descent, although, as it has been pointed out, the Chinese Caribbean community is much more well integrated into the community at large. So there's an opportunity, and many people take that opportunity where they go and they re-explore what they feel their cultural heritage should be. They say, well, now I'm going to learn about the food of India. I myself went through that period where I decided I was going to teach myself everything about Indian food, especially since people expected that I would know how to make Indian food. So when someone asked me for a really good, you know, recipe for aloo gobi, I wanted to be able to give it to them. But part of it was a little bit of a charade, you know. I was kind of pretending that, yeah, I knew this because I'm Indian or half Indian, as the case may be. So this is a question that many people are faced with, the second, third, and fourth generation. Or do you maintain the food ways that you had at home? This is a comforting thing. You know, everybody wants to go to their mother's house and eat the thing that they ate as a child. So there's that very strong pull. You know, do you want to go home and eat pilau because you did on New Year's every year, even though you don't know why, but you did. So this is where I see that this whole question is going to go. I very much see this in my cooking classes. Most of my cooking classes are actually not attended by foodies who are Caucasian or quote-unquote American. They are the second and third generation of Asian Caribbeans who want to know how to make their home food. So it's going to be very interesting for all of us as we see how this is played out. Because what's also going to happen is, on the other side of it, we're all American. You know, if you're born here, obviously you're an American. So you're going to take these very recipes, you're going to take these fusions, and you're going to add something to it to make it your own. And maybe that could be in part because of lack of ingredients, they're too difficult to procure, and so on. My brother, who's here today, is a master at this. He's really great at taking Trinidadian recipes and throwing in extra things to make it more his own. And they're often things that are not traditionally Trinidadian.
Like pizza.
Like pizza, yeah. So, but so that's where I see this going. And I think that what you're going to see in 20 years and 30 years is yet again a whole elaboration of Asian Caribbean food, where you're going to have people, and it's already happening in Trinidad right now. I can't speak to the other islands because I haven't explored it there, but in Trinidad, there is a movement to have 3- and 4-star dining with traditional foods. So you have things like pepper pot, and you have things like pilau, but they are presented in a French presentation. French culinary ingredients are added. The idea of nouvelle cuisine as is presented in Europe and America. And why? Because of things like food TV. There's cable and satellite TV in Trinidad. People watch food TV. You know, so they get the idea that they're going to take that same pilau and put it in a ring mold and present it with a sprig of rosemary. And that's fine, but it's already happening there. So where people are adapting to what is a more quote-unquote modern, sophisticated American Western presentation of food, and they're adding ingredients to it to make it even more so authentically nouvelle cuisine. And ironically, that's just like the West Indies spawned all of us to come to New York, to London, to Toronto, and all over the world. Now I think the next kind of airmail package that's being sent is this new food way, where you take authentic, what has become authentic West Indian foods and adapt them to an American style. So you're going to have, you know, Asian, Caribbean, nouvelle cuisine, and it's going to be indistinguishable to say what was Indian, what was Chinese, what was Spanish, what was African, and so on. So I would say that you should all look out for that. It'll be a wonderful taste experience, but I would also say that read your menus carefully if you want to know a little bit about the history of the Caribbean, because it's all right there for you in recipes and measurements and methods of preparation. Thank you.